Hi, I'm Mark, producer of Roundtable, the TV series born here in New York City at the legendary Manhattan Neighborhood Network Studios. The exchange of ideas is important, and that is why we bring to you the following presentation. Please watch.
Single shot at Manhattan Neighborhood Network. Last time we was talking about tendencies that art world experienced because of the pandemic, and one of the things we mentioned was actually narrative of the art. And we decided that we want to explore it a little deeper, and we have here again Michael Colavita, one of our favorite guests. Hello, Michael.
Hi.
Thank you for joining us tonight. And we are going to be talking about the complexity of narrative of the art pieces. And when we're talking about your art, they're usually pretty complex.
Sure.
just like my own works, they're combining several images in one final product. So if my believe that complexity of the narrative will be doing its comeback to the art world, it probably will be very advantageable for the art you create.
Sure, sure. It's interesting, as you know, on my large format 8x10 chromes, there's a lot of wealth of detail.
Yes.
I'm composing on ground glass that's 8x10 inches. So much like a painter, I just had this conversation with my 5-year-old son, Romeo, because he's doing a lot of painting. He draws like little, you know, he used to go like Spider-Man, now he's into Transformers. Mm. But he'll do different elements. He'll draw a Transformer, then he usually likes explosions, and he does many different things. And I likened it in a conversation with him to what I do, where on the 8x10 ground glass, I'll expose maybe a portrait. And then there'll be other elements that I add to this. So one by one, much like a painter as he's building his composition, I'm through 8x10 film, because as you know, it's the only film I shoot with.
Indeed.
Exposing up to 100 images on one piece of 8x10. Recently, I'd shown you something I did at the southern tip of Manhattan.
Yes.
Where I had 1,000 little elements of watch gears.
Yes.
Not 1,000 exposures, just many complex parts.
Mm-hmm.
That I took and photographed on the 8x10 film.
Yes.
And there was a little watchtower with a clock that I exposed in 6 or 7 places, you know, again, a pretty complex piece of art. While riding my bicycle down there to scout, that's what I've been doing lately, late at night, early in the morning, even 2 o'clock, I'll get on my bike, I'll scout New York City to see if there are any architectural elements I can use for some new work. I saw a building that's like just south of 14th Street that was really interesting in that it looked like a modern sort of pyramid with different angularity. And it's funny because complex is always basically what I'm doing when I'm combining elements. But in the case of that image, which we'll show, which I showed you, mm-hmm. and was very happy about, I kept it very simple there. I only did a couple of exposures to redefine or to reshape this building and this structure and to add a certain, you know, architectural feel to it that was wonderful, but it was about simplicity, you know, even though it was a complex way that I technically mm-hmm. did the image.
Yes.
And just again, in the last 3 days ago, I went down to the southern tip, the east side now of Manhattan, and I shot the municipal building, which reminded me of when I was very, very young, and I got into 8x10, I was like in my 17, 18, 19, when I hit 20 years old, I was doing a lot of time-lapse photography of New York City in 8x10. And I actually went to that building, the municipal building, and a gentleman got me access to one of the offices, and he almost had a heart attack when he saw me open up the window and go out on the ledge, which was about, I don't know, 2 feet wide, and set up my A10 view camera, because at that time I wanted a shot of the entrance to the Brooklyn Bridge, and there were two looping roadways, which is a wonderful composition. Perhaps we'll present this also.
Yeah.
And I did an hour time exposure. I mean, I set the camera up, I clicked the shutter, and I came back in. The gentleman who set me up with it actually ran out of the room. He told me later he was horrified. He almost had a heart attack to see what I was doing. Wow. But this time, I went back to that same area and shot the actual building. The municipal building has a tower on the top that's lit in white with a golden crown on the top of some sort. And I've been waiting for weather because it's been thunderous and raining lately. So I got a clear night. I went out. I exposed it 21 separate times in 21 different places. And often, as a painter would do, I'm doing this and feeling it as I go, because I do different compositions, and I'm not really sure what the outcome is going to be. Sometimes it's mathematical, and I do know what I want to do. In this case, it was more of a freestyle. So I built it up, and I needed one more tower, and I got clouds now that took over, which scared me, because I needed a clear sky so that none of the images would interact or interfere, I should say, with what was already recorded on the film. And I got lucky in that that last image turned out completely clean and you couldn't see the clouds. I used Velvia 50 film, which is high contrast, and at night it worked beautifully. So to add to the complexity of this shot, same day, that same night, I went back to my place. It was now, I think, like 1 o'clock in the morning. And I took a quick bike ride just by the East River. And I noticed that there were extreme reflections happening from the 59th Street Bridge when you look to the left, north, and when I look to the right, south, in the far distance were other bridges. And I thought to myself, am I going to be crazy now and run back up to my apartment, get my A10 view camera set up, and shoot all this? And in the back of my mind, I was thinking, wow, I can add this yellow golden reflection effect to what I already had for that municipal building shot. And I did it. It was another 12 exposures. It turned out to be about 40 exposures on that one piece of film. And all of those elements complemented each other. And it really is a very special piece of work that I'm very happy with, because, I mean, I'm trying to let the wind blow me, so to speak, in a different direction every time I create. In the nightmare of this whole pandemic, I have been, you know, reluctant to approach too many people. Because a lot of my photography is about people, body shots, portraits. And I'm not afraid of that. And it's, you know, I'm not really worried about the spread of this thing. That's a whole nother discussion. But I have been forced, in a sense, to, you know, again, do something a little bit different. And the architectural elements and that arena of my work is something I really like to focus on anyway.
Different is good. I mean, all artists, in one way or another, had to redefine the way they approach their work. And creating something completely different from what he was doing before is actually a pretty good outcome.
Absolutely. Yes, and I discovered something. I mean, in my 21 fundamental principles of pure photography, which we've spoken about before, there are many things I will not do. It's all about the organic picture-taking process.
Yes.
Doesn't matter how many exposures, but I won't use color filters. I don't shoot through glass or mirrors. One of the things I specify that I don't do is use reflections. And what I really mean by that is I won't have an image through a mirror or an image through a piece of glass, reflections in that sense. So I need to be clear in that I just kind of discovered now, through shooting these reflections in the water of the lights, something new, which I think I'm going to explore more.
Absolutely.
Where, you know, the reflections and the colors, they're magnificent on the Velvia. You know, it's just such a wonderful thing to look at. The only problem with it is, as much of the location work I do, is it's now so agonizing to deal with a still water that's like beautifully giving me this mirror effect. Mm-hmm. And then wouldn't you know it, you see in the distance a boat starting to go by. So the second the boat passes, my reflections are gone. I have to wait like 40 minutes to, you know, let everything settle down. And it's like everything when you shoot outdoors. We have to worry about people and crowds. And there's always these extra elements that make it more of a pain for the artist to do his thing.
In your process, moving objects indeed could be a big obstacle. Your process, in a way, is the long exposure on steroids, so you don't need just one long exposure, you actually need multiple.
And I understand, actually, with Impressionism, a big part of that story was the Impressionists are out there, and it's more of a less detailed and exact photographic image quality painting that you know resulted from that whole style. And I think a lot of it was that they were painting fast outdoors and working with the existing light. And the light would change and the shadows would change, so they have to move like a little bit quicker and, you know, hence a slightly different style that's not as exact in approach.
We'll get back to this after the break. Alex AG again from Single Shot with another single trick. Today I want to tell you about using internal flash of the camera. Even some very professional cameras have that, but if you would ask a professional photographer, including myself, you would be told not to use it, especially on close-ups and especially when you're photographing people. Reason being, when you do it, the face being overblown, you're getting practically a white face instead of having nice skin tones and nice lighting. Is there anything you can do about it? Actually, yes, there is. You can just put in front of your flash a simple dollar bill and take a picture. What it will give you, dollar bill is made of material thick enough to control enough light, and on top of it, it will give you some nice yellow tone to complement the skin tones of the person. This is a single trick by Single Shot. Watch us on YouTube. We're back, and we were talking about the beauty of reflections and the long exposures. I actually experienced a pretty similar situation when I was making photographs by my own technique, which actually incidentally using filters which you're refusing to use.
Okay.
So I needed to take three separate exposures of each slide of panorama.
So
for me, it was basically the same kind of situation. I needed to have three identical sceneries of each of the slides. So I know very well what you're talking about when you're talking about something disturbing the existing serenity of the picture.
Yeah, it's really hard to deal with. I actually have the Chrome right here, the 8x10.
Huh?
And what's good that I have it here is people can see, you know, an 8x10, the ground glass is this size.
Mm-hmm.
When I load the camera, I put the holder in the back. You know, first I compose the image in the ground glass. When I'm ready to take one shot of one tower, I put the holder in. Of course, the camera lens is closed, so it's dark inside, it's light tight.
Mm-hmm.
I was just describing this process to Romeo, how it really works. And then when I pull the holder out, it's still dark in here. The film is not mm-hmm. being subjected to light, or it would be ruined before, you know, development.
Yes.
But then when I click the shutter or do my 10-second to 1-minute exposure, however long it is, it records the image on the film. And, you know, you can see here where an 8x10 view camera is really the only way I can do my art. I could work in 4x5, but it's still much smaller. So if, like, one tower is an inch long, I can actually position it kind of like a pin registration and draw on the ground glass where that first tower was. So as I go and build up the composition, I mean, it's not a guessing game. If it was any smaller format, you'd kind of have to know visually, well, it was a little right and center or a little to the top of the frame. It could never be what 8x10 allows me to do.
In your case, it's still a guessing game because the only time you see the final image is after the development.
I like that you say that. Yeah, that's one great thing about, you know, well, the guessing game is, it's not really a guessing game. It's more about, oh my God, what exactly does it look like? You know, being a master of this art and somewhat of a mathematician and scientist in a sense, in my ability to understand light and what the film emulsions should look like, I'm usually pretty close. I usually am like not that in any way disturbed or startled by what I see. I mean, if I get something a little different, it's always something that, again, is really out of my control. Maybe conditions in the sky that night, where the colors react differently on the film. But typically here, I'm speaking more about positioning and composition in terms of structure, where I can know exactly where all the elements are. And as you say, with film, much different than digital, you know, I can't see as I'm going what I'm doing. Exactly. I have to do these 50 exposures, and if I made any mistake anywhere, which, you know, knock wood, I usually don't do, then when I see the film, the nightmare is like, oh my God, the whole shoot is wasted.
So you can actually predict if something went wrong before you actually can see the physical image.
I mean, I usually know. I'm pretty exact. I've done this for so many years now, and my process is pretty, you know, true and doesn't drift. So I know, I mean, when I was really young and first started out, I would say to myself, oh my God, did I draw that first and expose that yet? Did I not expose it? And I really have never made a mistake that way. I used to drive myself crazy.
Can't imagine.
Because before you see the film, you never know for sure. And after years of not making mistakes, it just stopped. By the time I hit like 25, I stopped worrying about that. And I thought, you know, it's going to be what it's going to be, and I have to trust myself. And no matter how many exposures I have, and you know, many shoots fail. Because you think you like something or you think you want something and you look at it later and you say, well, what was the purpose? Yeah. Even with the reflections I just did here, in the back of my mind I thought, am I just forcing this? Am I just adding color and like a geometry? And I thought again, and I thought, no, I think this is really going to work because the actual structure is white with a golden top and all the reflections were golden. So I had to be careful. In this piece, I did two horizontal exposures on the top and the bottom, and I flipped the camera so one was facing up and one was facing down. Then I did angular, you know, same lineage, but angled on the top and the bottom. So it created kind of like a diamond framing these erratic placement of the tower. And it just absolutely, it blew my mind when I saw it. And this goes to what you were saying. I really had no idea how that was going to feel in the end. I mean, I knew like structurally what was there, but I didn't know if those colors and the reflections were going to work with the white and the gold. And when I saw it, I thought, oh my God, this is so much better than had I not done that. I typically, when I shoot, we'll set the camera up, shoot one sheet of film, flip the holder, and shoot another. So I'll have the same exact composition on two pieces of film. And I'll process the first. So that if, like, I want to change something, like push or pull the film, you know, for exposure, I can do that. And often, if I love what I have, I may save the second piece for elements to another composition in the future. I have four or five shots right now of watch gears, of like different, you know, pieces that I shot maybe up to a year ago. I have five pieces right now that I'm just waiting for the right subject. There's some body form I want to do now to add to some of these other compositions that's already on the film. And of course I have acetates and everything lined up so I can put it back on the ground glass and you know what I'm doing for the next part of the exposures.
This is actually fascinating. You never mentioned this part of your process, and that really feels like objects suspended in time, really.
Absolutely, absolutely.
This is really fascinating. Sounds like science fiction, the plot for the science fiction book.
And I hear, I mean, I've heard artists say, photographers, that they found film that hadn't been exposed, or processed, mm-hmm. I should say, had been processed. Exposed, but not developed for 10, 15 years. And yes. They went and developed it, and the image was still there.
Absolutely. I've heard stories like this, too.
So
the
I've
oldest
never
one, World War II time.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I've never pushed it that far. I mean, I think the longest I've ever had something, you know, held for something in the future has been maybe a year and a half. And I usually don't like to go too long because then I get excited. It's like, oh, God, I want to see this in another form, you know?
What makes it special, specifically, this anticipation of continuation of the process.
Yeah.
Yes, there was a lot of times when the film was just forgotten for one reason or another and was exposed decades after, but this particular situation when film is basically half exposed to its final state and the time between one and the other exposition is about a year, that's something I never heard of, and philosophically and aesthetically, just the thought of it is strangely pleasing.
Yeah, no, it is. In fact, I'm excited talking to you about it because I know in the back of my mind there were four or five compositions not completed that I'm really looking forward to marrying to something else. I'm not really sure what it's going to be.
I actually realized what it reminds me of all those elements of nature that are frozen inside of the amber stones.
Sure.
So this amber stone that was millions of years freezing an instance of life, which in modern times becomes part of the jubilee and takes its final form.
Wow, that's interesting.
That's something like this.
Yeah.
All right, we'll have a few minutes after the break to finalize this conversation. Conscious decision to switch altogether, there will be a lot of things you will need to learn and a lot of things you will need to change in the way you photograph. But there is one thing that is very important and you will really have to know it in order to avoid major disappointments. In digital, as you probably know, if you take a photograph, you really have to make sure it's not overexposed. Otherwise, there is nothing you can do. In RAW, white is always white. You can't change it. In film, on the other hand, overexposed image can be corrected through development of the negative, but underexposure sometimes is completely fatal and final. So just make sure that you will change it underexposure for overexposure. All right, we're back, and we was talking about moments frozen in your negatives, still waiting to be completed and developed. So we have a few minutes left, so let's try to talk a little bit about how this pandemic have affected your artistic process. You mentioned that you had less opportunities to photograph people. Was there anything else in which way it affected it?
I mean, it affected me mentally for a little while in that I had no desire to really shoot. You know, I just, when I saw the craziness going on in the world, and then that, excuse me, that parlayed with museums and what's happening with art, and I noticed how, I mean, all the museums closed and the art world was completely dead. And I'm about as positive as it gets when it comes to just energy in life and loving my art and wanting to create it. And I don't create art so that I could become famous in any way, shape, or form. I create art because I'm moved by life and because I know that once I create something, it's really way beyond myself. It's for society. It's for people. It's for people to, like, be inspired by. I don't need a critique, like people loving it or not liking it. It's not really about that. It's more about I do it so it won't sit in a drawer, but so that eventually it can get out there and people can react one way or another. So for me, to be sort of put in a place, not of depression, I should say. I wasn't depressed. I was overwhelmed with maybe boredom in a sense. And I mean bored of the whole world of art and how it just felt that no matter what I create now, I mean, for the first time in my life, it was like, well, how is it really going to matter? And there's another side to that. Whether or not my work is in a great museum show worldwide or not, one thing I have in a very confident and positive way is that I know the art is what it is. I answer to myself first when I create something. Mm-hmm. Once I've created something and it makes my top tier level of art list, I'm really satisfied. I always wonder and marvel at why isn't this taking, you know, a political place now and being shown everywhere, but that's not what drives me. That's not what motivates me. I believe so strongly in what I do. I've seen many other artists and photographers where they started to question themselves when they weren't getting successful either financially or through shows or galleries and getting good results, where they started to wonder if what they were doing was even valid or good. I've never fortunately had that problem. I know what I'm doing, I know what I'm focusing on, and if I don't get something, I'm really depressed because I wanted something so badly and it didn't happen. But I'm not worried about the onlookers.
Let's hope that our art world will actually turn its face to the artists who really deserve the exposure and who are really trying to make this world a better place. And
absolutely,
we all know that you're one of those artists. Well, thank you very much, Michael. It was a pleasure as always.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
Good.
I hope you found that worth watching as much as I did.
I'm Mark
for Roundtable.
Thanks for watching.
See you next week.